Our world is changing. Every day, it changes a little faster. Some changes are too small to see. Others, too big to handle. Sometimes, change feels slow. So slow, we don't even notice. Other times, it happens all at once. We can't keep up. For our climate, change means many things. And between too small to see and too big to handle, there is a whole world of difference. The clock is ticking. This is Bloomberg Green.
Taking the temperature on Capitol Hill, this week, the White House goes green. The president-elect is pushing the most aggressive climate policy the United States has ever seen. Will Biden succeed, and could it change America for good? And 4 years of rollbacks and doubling down on fossil fuels, we appraise the state of U.S. climate policy as the Trump administration comes to a close. And what can we learn from Paradise? Reduced to nothing in 2018, Paradise, California is rebuilding from the ashes. How the West Coast is preparing for a new age of fire. From Bloomberg's European headquarters in London, I'm Annmarie Hordern. First up, your Green in Brief.
I'm Jennifer Zabasadja in New York. Here's everything you need to know in Green this week. President-elect Joe Biden is planning the most progressive climate policy the U.S. has ever seen. He's promising to rejoin the Paris Climate Agreement and calling for the U.S. to have net zero emissions by 2050. But this $2 trillion agenda is likely to face strong opposition from Republican lawmakers. The world's richest countries risk missing their pledge to help the poorest nations combat climate change. Funding has slowed since President Trump pulled the U.S. out of the Paris Agreement. The OECD says they need to urgently step up their efforts. The transition to cleaner energy isn't just a necessity, it's a great opportunity, too. That's according to Mark Carney, now focusing his efforts on tackling climate change. He's calling on companies to play their part in re-engineering a greener economy.
This is the biggest commercial opportunity of our time. The companies that are part of the solution are creating enormous, enormous value and will be rewarded for it by the markets. And the markets are waking up to that.
And the UK is raising the bar on climate disclosures, telling companies they have to report risks from global warming. It's the first major economy to make the move, but almost certainly won't be the last. Concerns still remain. The plan only scratches the surface of what's needed to combat climate change.
The original climate activist, Greenpeace, has never been afraid of angering institutions to get its message across. It's had its fair share of controversies, but it's not just whaleboat boarding activists. Today, it's lobbyists, journalists, researchers, all working to raise the profile of environmental issues. And this year, climate change made it onto the ballot. Executive Director Jennifer Morgan says Joe Biden's climate plan is bold, but just a start.
Certainly, it is the most ambitious climate package we've ever seen being presented and has broad support across society. I think what we're hoping for is that he stays the course.
Republican Senator Mitt Romney congratulated President-elect Biden, but he's said that he's not going to put the conservative principles, the conservative agendas on hold.
I want to make sure that we conservatives keep on fighting to make sure that we don't have a Green New Deal, we don't get rid of gas and coal and oil.
What realistically do you think a Biden White House can get done if the Senate remains in Republican control?
Well, two thoughts on that. I think that conservative principles underpin a taking care of Americans, which includes the most vulnerable to climate impacts. And so I think that there are many conservative leaders around the world who understand the science of climate change and the urgency. That being said, I think that Biden, President-elect Biden, will need to be very clear in his intention. And the voters in Georgia will need to have climate change as one of the key things that they're looking at when they do their runoff votes.
Day one for you, what would be the first executive order that should hit his desk?
Day one, he should have an executive agreement to re-enter the Paris Agreement and commit to the national commitments that they had already pledged, which are based on executive authority, and to stand in solidarity with the most vulnerable people in the United States and around the world.
At Davos this year in January, you have this report about the financial sector, and you say they're the ones that are most culpable to the climate emergency. This week, the UK introduced rules requiring a majority of UK-listed companies to disclose how climate changes affect their businesses. What do you make of that, and who do you expect could come next?
I think this is a very important piece of work, and the financial regulation. So these aren't voluntary commitments. It's basically saying that companies and governments also need to take climate change risks, so the impacts themselves and what they're investing into as a material risk in their decision making. I expect this is also part of the Biden-Harris set of actions. They would also be looking at regulating financial risk. China has looked at this in the past. France already had some things in place. The European Central Bank is doing a review of its policies right now. This can cause a very quick domino effect. Who wants to invest in fossil fuels when it's so clear how unprofitable they will be when you start integrating those risks?
When you look at the fossil fuel companies, we've seen a lot of ones in Europe really talk about the transition into renewables. Do you think that the tide is shifting for sure with fossil fuel companies? And in the future, is there a place for them if they adapt?
I think we are starting to see some fossil fuel companies recognize that it's not just their own operations, it's their fundamental product that needs to shift. These net zero commitments, though, you have to look at the details. It cannot be done by planting trees somewhere. It cannot be done by saying you're going to do carbon capture and storage, which isn't gonna solve it. It has to be a fundamental business rethink. If those companies are ready to move into and provide energy services that are clean and renewable in the future, there is a role for them. If they aren't, then there needs to be a transition, and it needs to be just for their workers.
The next 5 to 10 years, everything you focus on, what are you most excited about in the climate space?
I'm most excited about the fact that there's a recognition of the systemic challenges, the systemic problems that we have, whether it be oppression of people through systemic racism that's happening, whether it be through the inequality of rich and poor, or whether it be climate justice. These things are all connected. Movements are working together, people are understanding, and they want a better future, and they're ready to fight for it. And I think that's incredibly exciting.
Coming up, Paradise Regained, a town completely destroyed by wildfires, is being rebuilt, this time fireproof. This is Bloomberg Green.
Climate change is happening. It needs to be repeated over and over.
126 governments have now committed to net zero.
We also must harness the firepower of the financial sector.
The financial community has a critical role to play in driving this transition.
We're going to lay out for our stakeholders how we intend to align with the Paris Accord.
The investment industry now has the opportunity to further accelerate this phenomenon and demonstrate that we could be a catalyst for change.
The economic challenges of the climate transition are phenomenal. And then I ask myself, how much does it cost? A lot. But nothing that we cannot afford, because the cause is our survival.
Policymakers, politicians, and executives unified in their message on climate change at the Green Horizon Summit. This is Bloomberg Green, and I'm Annmarie Hordern in London. Now, wildfires are some of the most violent manifestations of our changing environment. Camp Fire in 2018 was the deadliest and most destructive wildfire in California's history. More than 150,000 acres of land were burned, and 86 people were killed. The small foothill town of Paradise in Butte County was caught in the path of the firestorm, displacing tens of thousands of people and causing billions in damage. Now, more than 2 years later, Paradise is rebuilding, learning from the lessons of its past.
The tally of death and destruction keeps growing in the Northern California wildfires.
Thick clouds of ash are turning day into night.
2020 has been yet another record wildfire season. Over the last few years, wildfires have been raging not just in the western U.S., but all around the world. While fires have long been a natural part of many forest ecosystems, higher temperatures and longer droughts caused by climate change are drying out forests and turning trees into tinder. In California, wildfire seasons have become supercharged. Towns like Paradise, California, where the 2018 campfire destroyed over 80% of its homes, are now grappling with how to adapt to this new age of fire, starting from essentially the ground up.
It is literally like the surface of the moon there.
2 years later, as the town still works to rebuild, the local Parks and Recreation District is beginning an ambitious plan to not just restore Paradise, but make sure it can better defend itself from the next fire. CityLab reporter Laura Bliss went to see this firsthand.
It was a pretty haunting experience. Just thousands and thousands of homes, literally reduced to shells. It really still is this landscape of disaster.
I guess, what has the scale of rebuilding been like?
So I checked with the city, and there's been about 400 homes that have already been reconstructed. And about 1,200 that are currently permitted. There are some people who are thinking a little bit differently about what the future of Paradise should look like. One resident I spoke to has actually gone forward with selling her land so that eventually it might become part of a large green belt encircling the city. And the person who's leading this project is not a member of city government. He's actually the manager of the Paradise Recreation and Parks District.
My name is Dan Fsep. I'm the district manager for the Paradise Recreation and Park District.
And Dan believes what the park district can start to do is improve what's known as the wildland-urban interface.
That line was very much blurred or a razor's edge. So the idea here is that we would take that very narrow, razor-sharp wildland-urban interface now and expand it out in such a way that we would have a buffer. At the same time, providing these kind of extraordinary recreational resources and opportunities. So areas that could be parks, they could be returned in some cases to orchards. We're interested in ag tourism in the area. So what we're trying to do is take this idea of defensible space around a house that someone might take and expand that to defensible space around the community.
Earthquake. We have major cities all up and down the West Coast that sit on major earthquake faults. We've mitigated that. We've engineered our way into having less danger associated with earthquakes in major cities. And we can do the same with fire. We just haven't done it yet.
This is Crystal Colden, and she considers herself a pyrogeographer.
Green belts are a type of fuel rake, right? Green belts are, of course, these areas where a lot of the understory is removed under trees, or if there's no trees at all, shrubland areas are modified so that they become essentially park-like grasslands. I actually published a study last year about a series of fire breaks and what was essentially a green belt around the community of Montecito, California.
Between the years of 1999 and 2017, Montecito would spend over $1.6 million on wildfire vulnerability reduction activities.
They did it little by little. It's individual properties, it's along roads where they have space to work. And when we actually went back and looked at the satellite data, it looks a little bit like a green necklace.
And in 2017, the Thomas Fire would put that work to the test.
The calmer conditions in Santa Barbara County Wednesday didn't mean flames stopped threatening multi-million dollar homes in Montecito.
This is the fifth largest fire in California history.
And when that fire hit Montecito, there were winds blowing over 60 miles an hour. There were gusts up to 72 miles an hour, and that was the last thing we had recorded before the weather station burned down. And when it got to that green belt along the edge of the town, it basically did exactly what the green belt was designed to do, which is it died down, it allowed firefighters to move in close and work safely to put water on the edge of the fire, to put retardant on the edge of the fire, and actually drop it down to the ground. ground and put it out. And it is one of the few cases that is really well documented retrospectively and spatially of a green belt working well. And we're trying to find more of those, but it's a challenge.
And maybe the biggest challenge for Paradise is paying for all of this. Early estimates put the cost of acquiring and maintaining all this land in the tens of millions of dollars.
You know, we're absolutely of the mind, we have to be respectful of all our decisions by landowners. But, you know, I think the idea is right now there is such a receptivity to people wanting to do some things that help the community. Potentially, we could serve a model on a whole bunch of different levels, not just the parks and how to protect the community, but how do we take care of our people.
Coming up, a greener America. President-elect Joe Biden has proposed the most radical climate plan in U.S. history, but is it realistic? We look at what's possible and how it may shape the American economy of tomorrow. This is Bloomberg Green.
We lost 4 years in the U.S. under the Trump administration. That's the U.S. was practically absent from the fight against climate change. Before that, let's have in mind 8 years of the George W. Bush era, where the U.S. as well was more or less absent in the fight against climate change. So we have to hurry up. There is high pressure, high expectations.
Great expectations from the German Green Party for the Biden administration's climate goals. Let's take a closer look at those 4 years and where Joe Biden finds U.S. climate policy today.
If you look at the Paris Accord, it was a disaster from our standpoint.
President Trump's withdrawal of the Paris Climate Accord was a major symbolic blow and made media headlines everywhere. But many of the mechanisms for environmental stewardship exist in an esoteric regulatory world. A closer look into the Environmental Protection Agency and other government offices reveals a clearer picture of what 4 years under the Trump administration has meant for the environment.
The single biggest obstacle to building a modern transportation system has been the mountains and mountains of bureaucratic red tape.
Transportation creates more greenhouse gases than any other sector. Rules surrounding how infrastructure development and pollutants cross state borders were revised, and states sometimes found themselves pitted against the federal government. California tried setting tough tailpipe laws, only to have them blocked, and Obama-era fuel efficiency targets were slashed. The Trump EPA has rejected the science around air pollution and the recommendations of its own employees. Rules that control toxic emissions, including mercury, from oil and coal production were relaxed, even though a lot of facilities had already complied.
You know, we're planting a billion trees, the Billion Tree Project.
Despite multiple mentions, there's no evidence the administration is conducting any such campaign. And speeding the process by which public land is leased for drilling will have far greater detrimental impact. One such area is the National Arctic Wildlife Refuge, a 19 million acre reserve considered one of the last untouched wildernesses. The Clean Water Act has been handicapped, exposing rivers, lakes, and other wetlands to pollution. Protections for intermittent water bodies that depend on rain were expanded in order to safeguard drinking water for 117 million people, but the Trump administration slashed those protections, claiming them burdensome to farms and golf courses. The pesticide chlorpyrifos, which has been banned in U.S. homes for 20 years, was about to be forbidden on outdoor crops. But the administration halted the move. The EPA no longer supports the ban despite evidence it causes developmental problems in children. Biodiversity protections have been tossed aside by opening up marine and nature preserves to exploitation and reducing hunting and fishing protections. And changes to the way the Endangered Species Act is applied makes it harder to protect life in general.
Trump is the great environmentalist. Do you hear that, Ed? Do you hear that?
But it's not just what the Trump administration has done or removed. It's what it's not doing as well. Well, there's been zero federal investment in renewable energy and innovation. They've even proposed subsidizing coal and nuclear generation in markets where other sources are cheaper. Oversight has thinned out, and increased efforts to hold polluters accountable for more cleanup costs has been halted, leaving taxpayers with more of the bill. The Biden campaign has promised one of the most ambitious green overhauls of the economy ever, but a lot of damage control can be achieved by simply reinforcing and sticking to commitments that have already been made.
Joining us now is our Bloomberg Green resident expert, Akshat Rathi. Akshat, thanks so much for joining us. So President-elect Joe Biden campaigned on the most ambitious climate plan we've ever seen from a U.S. presidential candidate. He wants to do everything, weatherizing our homes, EVs in the driveways. That's going to take years. What could we see in the first 100 days?
We know that he's already promised on first day he's going to rejoin the Paris Climate Agreement. We also know he has power in pushing through executive orders, rolling back the rollbacks that the Trump administration made. So, for example, cutting methane emissions from the oil and gas industry. And he can put in place across the administration people who understand and want to act on climate. And this is not just in the Department of Energy or the Environmental Protection Agency, but also in the Federal Reserve, in the SEC, or in other regulatory bodies that will affect the climate one way or another.
So climate-minded people in other posts, not just dedicated to the environment or climate. You know we have this runoff Senate race in Georgia in January, so we don't know yet there's this cloud about whether or not the Senate will remain Republican. But if it does remain in GOP hands, how much harder is that going to make it for him? What, realistically, what can he get done?
He may not be able to reach the promises he's made. For example, he wants the U.S. to have 100% carbon-free electricity by 2035. Without legislation that passes both the houses of Congress, he's not going to be able to get that. But we do know that there are some things on which there's bipartisan consensus. So both the Republicans and Democrats agree that innovation is quite important. And we may see the Biden administration push through billions of dollars in funding for clean energy innovation in, say, renewable energy or batteries or hydrogen.
He's been president-elect for about a week now. He's made some moves in terms of climate. I mean, walk us through what's been going on.
A surprising amount has happened in a week. We know that, for example, he put out his transition plan, which has four priorities. Climate change is one of them. He spoke to the leaders of the UK, France, Germany, Canada, and in all of those conversations, among other priorities, climate change got a mention. So we know when Biden comes and becomes president, the US will be seen differently already on climate issues. And surprisingly, some administration or parts of the administration are taking this as a signal to start moving on climate. So Bloomberg just broke a story this week that the Federal Reserve is looking to join the climate club of central bankers.
Right, and to do that, you need to be part of, your nation needs to be part of the Paris Climate Agreement. So they're front-running the fact that Biden is going to bring America back into
Indeed.
The Paris Climate Agreement. Where does this leave America in the race to be, you know, the greenest country in the world? Because the European Union, at the moment, probably has the most ambitious plan.
That's correct. Biden has promised that the U.S. will go to net zero greenhouse gas emissions by 2050. That's what every rich country will have to do to try and stave off the worst effects of climate change. But that's not enough, because even the short term matters. The EU, as you mentioned, has the most ambitious plan there, cutting emissions by 55% by 2030. So if the US wants to regain its leadership, it'll have to at least match that goal or have something more ambitious.
55% by 2030, that's what to watch. All right, Akshat Rathi, our resident green reporter here at Bloomberg News, thank you so much. That does it for Bloomberg Green. Keep the conversation going, though. Follow us on Twitter @climate. I'm Annmarie Hordern. This is Bloomberg Green.